everyone. I am really excited today. I have a guest here for you. Well, not exactly here with me. He is practically on the other side of the world from me, but I am going to give him a call through Skype, and then you guys are going to get to meet him and learn all about what he does. So we got him on Skype now. So if you want to go ahead and introduce yourself and tell us about where you're from.
Yeah, of course. So hi, everyone. My name is Ryan Cartledge, and I'm from New Zealand. But I've been really fortunate over the last decade or so to work not only here in this country, but also internationally as a professional animal trainer. So I've also worked in Australia, in the US, and in Canada. Now, not only have I been fortunate, you might see a little head sticking up there. We have my beautiful Phoebe dog joining us today as well. I've been really fortunate to work alongside a whole range of animals, as well as at a whole bunch of different facilities. I've worked with species from penguins to tigers, and with zoo teams, and run programs across whole collections and with the entire teams. I've worked alongside pet owners and their animals. I've presented at international conferences. I've got articles published in industry magazines. I've presented at Auckland University on animal behavior and training, and I do interviews like this, and the list goes on. Nowadays, I run my own online space where I teach others about positive reinforcement animal training, and it's my goal to help disseminate information about positive reinforcement animal training and about helping people learn how to work with their animals, set their environments up correctly, and implement practices based on techniques that help build trust, choice, and cooperation with their animals. At the end of the day, though, one thing that I realize is the more I learn, the less I know. So I identify with the term lifetime learner, and I just love interacting with people and animals and learning and growing together. So that's really my passion.
Wow, that's amazing. That sounds like such a great job to have, and just such a fun thing to go and do every day. Can you tell us about some of the zoos that you've worked at?
Yeah, so I've worked for numerous organizations, and they haven't all been zoos. As an employee, I've worked at three different zoos in Australia: Rockhampton Zoo, Cairns Tropical Zoo, and a place called Billabong Sanctuary in Townsville as well. In Canada, I worked at this massive safari park called African Lion Safari, which was amazing. And in the States, I interned for a fantastic company called Natural Encounters in Dallas, Texas, so not far from you, there in El Paso, Megan. And here in New Zealand as an employee, I've worked at Wellington Zoo, Kiwi Birdlife Park, and also as a consultant at a few other zoos here in New Zealand as well. Now, currently, my role has me interacting with zookeepers daily internationally in the Americas, in Europe, in Asia, in the Middle East, here in New Zealand, in Australia. And so I get to work with entire teams of zookeepers online, and I get to work with individual keepers as well. So I'm really fortunate. I've got this huge collection of amazing animal trainers and keepers that I interact with on a daily basis from zoos all around the world. And like you say, I'm really lucky to have found myself in this position. It's a lot of fun.
Wow, so that is a lot of places that you've trained at. So can you tell us, like, what kind of animals have you worked with then? If you've, you know, been to so many places, I'm assuming that you must have encountered some really amazing animals.
Well, at heart, I am a bird nerd. So over my career, the majority of my time has been spent training birds to free fly for educational shows. But working with all these zoos and all these keepers, I do get to work with a huge array of different species. And some people ask me what animals my content and my techniques work for. They're not my techniques, but the techniques that I encourage and promote. And the answer is anything with a pulse. So nowadays, we're working with your cats and your dogs. We're working with a huge array of different parrot species. We're working with a large amount of different birds. We're working with things like geckos. So we've been working with a rough-throated leaf-tailed gecko, and this is a nocturnal cryptic species. And we're working towards trying to manage and intervene and get this animal to do behaviors on cue, which is what the training is all about. We'll talk about that a little bit later. We're working with goldfish. We're training people's goldfish. Like I said, basically anything that has a pulse. Megan and I are going to discuss why this works with goldfish, geckos, and dogs and cats and parrots a little bit later on. But I have been fortunate, and I continue to be fortunate to work with anything and any animal that people ask me to help them out with and work with. But in your zoos, you know, like I mentioned earlier, anything from penguins to tigers to bears to lions, all the parrots, all the reptiles, all the mammals, marsupials. I know that you just released, Megan, I believe recently, a video on sugar gliders. Today I'm going to connect with a keeper in Melbourne, Australia. We're going to do what's called a mentor course, and me and her are going to connect online for a couple of hours, and we're going to talk about a ringtail possum. So we work a lot with possums, and gliders are a smaller species of the possum family. So some of that content might be relevant for your viewers there. And when I think about what animals I work with, for me it's all about the individual animal though. So what types of animals have I worked with? I've worked with all those species, but then I've also worked with a huge amount of different personalities. So I might work with 10 Labradors in a row, but they're going to be 10 completely individual animals. And that's the joy of what I do. It's taking all the information and all the knowledge about positive reinforcement animal training and applying it to the individual in front of you. So what types of animals have I worked with? Absolutely everything. And when I talk about personalities, you know, one of the main things that I talk about and I try to teach others is that each animal is an individual. So some great examples from some of the podcasts are audio that's available on my website. So I have my own podcast show where you can listen to me talk to and interview some of the world's leading experts on animal training. And some great examples from some of the podcasts interviews that I've done. One was from a guy called Chris Jenkins, who works for Natural Encounters that I was talking about before, and he talks about a Harris hawk. So a species of hawk that he trained using moss. So traditionally you might use some mouse or some chicken or some other form of meat to train a hawk, but they managed to train behaviors with this animal because somebody said to them, hey, that animal's looking a little bit broody. It looks like it wants to nest. So they thought, well, we're not getting anywhere by offering this animal traditional types of food that we would offer a hawk. So they went, okay, let's test this theory. They went outside, they got some moss from a tree, and they came inside and they offered this moss to this hawk contingent upon, so after it did the behaviors that they wanted, and they managed to teach it new behaviors by giving it opportunity to interact with moss. I talked to Lisa Longo from France. She was training some parrots in her zoo over there. She had 10 macaw parrots, and she trained them to voluntarily allow the staff there to wrap them up in a towel so that they could be handled for veterinary procedures. And she trained 9 of them. I think it was 10. Sorry if I got that wrong, Lisa. She trained 9 of them using food. Once again, the traditional things that you might offer a parrot when you're training it and the techniques that I teach. And the 10th one, they just couldn't figure it out. And they kept trying, they kept trying. They figured out that it was tactile stuff. So the parrot wanted interactions. And not only that, it wanted interactions from a specific staff member. And once they figured out that, they managed to train that parrot faster than the previous 9. So it's really cool getting to work with all these species. But what really excites me is getting to meet the individual animals I work with. Every single animal that I come across in every single situation and every single person that works with that animal is completely unique. And every situation is different. So I've worked with absolutely everything. I'm sure moving forward, there's going to be many opportunities to learn and grow and work with behaviors, species, and people that are completely novel. So every day is an exciting day, and I never know what it's going to bring.
Okay, so tell us about your training method and why it works for so many species, because from what you just mentioned, that is just so many different kinds of animals.
Yeah, definitely. And the methods that I use and the methods that I teach and the information that all of this stuff comes from is science. So all my methods are based on science, and you've heard me mention already in this interview two words, positive reinforcement. So we're going to talk a little bit about that and how that works. The classic example that a lot of people think about is if you have a dog and you say to your dog, sit, and your dog sits, and as a consequence of that, you deliver to your dog favorite food item. So maybe you give it a little piece of chicken. And what that communicates to the dog is, if I do this behavior, which is sit, good things happen. So it also pairs that with the command or the cue, whatever word you want to use, that you say before the behavior occurs, but the dog learns, the animal learns that if I do this behavior, then good things happen. So next time that animal's in that position and you say sit, the dog has memory, it's learned. It's learned that last time it was in a similar situation and it did the behavior of sit, good things happen. So it's more likely to do that behavior again now. This works with dogs, it works with cats, it works with you at home, it works with me. It's not something that we've come up with, it's the laws that exist on planet Earth. Every single animal, whether it's a dog, whether it's a cat, whether it's a sugar glider, whether it's a possum, whether it's a giraffe, lemur, wombat, rhino, it doesn't matter. If an animal does a behavior, and as a consequence of that behavior, something good happens, learning occurs. And next time it's in a similar situation, what we find is that the animals make the decisions to repeat those behaviors again. And that's why it works with all animals. If you think about yourself, if you do something for a friend, and then that friend comes along and gives you appreciation and gratitude and says thank you, and because of that it makes you feel good inside, next time that friend asks you to do something, then you're more likely to do it than if they just didn't say anything. Or whatever you like. Maybe your mum says to you, go clean your room, and if you do, you'll get some chocolate. Whatever it is. Chances are, if you like chocolate, you're going to clean your room again in the future. So that's how positive reinforcement works. That is one of the big, main, most important principles and techniques that you learn via the content on Animal Training Academy and the stuff I teach. And it's why it works with all these different species and all these different animals. But it's not the only thing. When we're thinking about behavior and when we're thinking about training, there's loads of other important concepts and techniques that we apply. And one of the most important ones that I thought I'd briefly mention today is relationships. Now, you can imagine that if you are the provider of chicken to your dog on a regular basis, your dog's going to see you and think, there's a chicken provider. There's Ryan, here he comes, good things are about to happen. So one place we frequently start, and this once again works with all animals, is we start on relationships and we start making sure that you as a trainer, you as the carer of that animal, have a good relationship with your animal based on trust, choice, and cooperation. Now, a great way of viewing this, and as you can imagine while I'm describing this to you, how it would work with your animal, or with all the animals I've talked about so far, is viewing it like a bank account. So imagine that you have a bank account, and my hand's going to represent that you've just opened your bank account and there's no money in there. All right? And every time you go to the bank and you put a dollar in, your bank account just starts getting a little bit bigger, a little bit bigger, and a little bit bigger. And if you withdraw money, your bank account starts getting smaller. And sometimes you can go into the red and you're in debt. So we view our relationships with our animals kind of like this. And often when we start, we say, what's your relationship like? Let's build on our bank account. We call it the trust account. So we might be starting a trust account that's got lots of deposits in it. We might be starting on a trust account with our animal that's in the red. We might be starting on neutral. But the idea is we figure out what that animal likes, what its reinforcers are. And just like a bank account, we start depositing reinforces in that trust account. And the idea is we want to have these really big trust accounts. We want to limit the amount of withdrawals, the amount of punishes we're putting in our animal's environment. We try to cut that down as close to zero as possible, and we just try to put as many good things in that animal's life as possible. The great thing about this is when we get a huge trust account, when we've got these great relationships with our animals, sometimes it necessitates that we go in and we might need to restrain them. We might need to grab them. We might need to take them to a vet, and something aversive needs to happen. But if you've got this amazing trust account with your animal and you take a withdrawal, quite often you're still in the positive. And that's the foundation of everything we do. And that works with all animals. When we start to build upon the trust account, our animals see us coming and they say, hey, here comes Ryan, here comes that person. Good things are about to happen. That is the foundation of everything and all the positive reinforcement and everything we do. And like I said, it works with all species. And one of the other things we do is we think about environment. So we look at our animal's environment and we figure out the behaviors that we've labeled as undesirable, and we figure out the behaviors that we would like to see from our animal, and we try to set the environment up in a way that makes it easy for our animals to do the behaviors that we want, and it makes it harder for the animals to do the behaviors that we don't want. Additionally, we make doing the behaviors we want more reinforcing. We make it so that when they do that, good things happen. And we make doing the behaviors that we've labeled as undesirable less reinforcing. So all of these things, it's not specific to one species. It's not specific to one type of animal. It's not specific to one individual animal. If we set the environment up well for any of the species we've talked about so far, and we start to put actions in place, will we become deliverers of positive reinforcement, and we're implementing that exact technique, positive reinforcement, we will start to move towards more desirable behaviors with all of the different species that we've been talking about today. So it's really exciting. And I mentioned before about that rough-throated leaf-tailed gecko, you know, and I mentioned additionally that the more I learn, the less I know. So with that species, I really had to go back to my textbooks, and I really had to spend some time learning about the natural history of this animal. But then once I'd done that, once we had examined our environment, once we've figured out what this animal wanted, then we could come in, we could be the deliverer of those mealworms and those crickets and all the things that this individual animal loved, started to pair them with ourselves, started to pair them with the behaviors we wanted, and we set the environment up so it was easy for that animal. And we started to move towards more of the behaviors we wanted. So it is universal, it is exciting, and it's all, once we spend time, really easy to learn as well, which is the great thing. Anyone can do this. It's not just me. Some people say, well, I watch these amazing videos on YouTube of these people doing these really cool things with their animals, or I saw it on Facebook. It's not magic though. It's just science. There's no illusions. It's all based upon the things I've just talked about, and you sitting there at home watching this video with whatever animal you have can start implementing this stuff today. You can start building those trust accounts and adding positive reinforcement into your animal's life. So it's, as mentioned, I'm really pumped about being on this video today, sharing this information with you, because it works with absolutely everything.
Wow, that sounds really exciting, especially that it can work for just, you know, any type of animal, and it can help you with your relationship. So based on, you know, what you just said, that what are some of your best experiences that you've had with animals that you've worked with?
Yeah, it's a great question. And there are some experiences that really stick out in my mind. At the end of the day, though, I just love connecting with people one-on-one. So every single person that I interact with is to me a great experience. And nowadays I spend more time training humans than I do training animals. And what's the biggest reinforcement for me? What's my piece of chicken that we can say is similar to the dog who sat, or the thank yous, is when I see the excitement that other people get after suddenly they've built these relationships with these animals, and they're starting to get new behaviors, and they've trained, they've taught their animal, they've communicated with their animal, hey, this is a behavior I'd like you to do. And the excitement and the joy and the enthusiasm that comes from that is what reinforces me, and it's what keeps me doing what I do. And it is my favorite thing in the world. Just a few days ago, I got sent a video. It was of some cotton top tamarins, a small species of primate. And they're at a zoo here in New Zealand called Natureland. Now, I went to Natureland in December 2015. And we had these little cotton top tamarins that wouldn't come into the room with us. It was a brand new room. They weren't used to this experience. So what did we do? We started building on those relationships. And we got our grapes, and we got our mealworms, and we got their favorite food items. And we only gave them to them. We didn't cut down as the amount that we gave to them, but we only gave them to those animals when we were there. So suddenly we became paired with all this good stuff. We started building these relationships. These little cotton top tamarins would run into the room, grab them, and run straight back out again. And you can actually see some of that content in the free course on Animal Training Academy. I got sent a video a few days ago of those same animals, same individuals, going voluntarily into a crate. So they chose to go into that space, the door shutting, latching, and then we were delivering positive reinforcement through the side. that to me is one of my favorite experiences. You know, how long is training going to take? How long is it going to take to train your animal to go into a crate? It could take a week, could take a month, it could take 12 months. Once again, it depends on the individual. But to see those results, to see these animals doing this stuff voluntarily, you know, we don't have to catch them if we want them to go to the vet. We don't have to stick them in a bag. We're going to go into that space with those animals. We're going to offer them the ability to go into a crate. We're going to open it up. Just like a dog, we say, sit. That's just information to the dog to communicate to it what we want it to do. We have a crate, we go in there, we open the door. This is information communicating to these animals what we want them to do. They make the decision based on the trust that we've built with them, based on the learning that we've provided with positive reinforcement, and they go into the crate voluntarily. And I can see that happening in front of me with a video that gets sent to me, and I can hear the excitement and enthusiasm in the keeper who's just communicated to a small species of primate. That's my main reinforcement. I absolutely love it. Now, to talk about some specific animal examples though, like I've mentioned, I am a bird nerd at heart. So I'm going to talk about three quickly that really stick out in my mind. Now, the first one is right there in Texas where you are, Megan, at the Birds of the World show that I participated in 2012 with Natural Encounters at the State Fair of Texas. Huge show, up to 5,000 people in the audience of this free flight bird show. One of the most amazing things from my time there was riding up in a carriage to the top of the Ferris wheel at the State Fair of Texas, a huge structure that was situated just behind the big amphitheater where we were doing these amazing shows for all these great people. And we would get the Ferris wheel controller to pause the mechanism, to pause the Ferris wheel when we were at the top. And what we'd do is we'd sit up there, we'd have a hawk with us. Now we had a white hawk, as well as a few other different individuals. But the white one was my favorite because it was so spectacular to look at. And we'd sit up there and we'd look down to the stage area. And when we saw a piece of communication from our team members, a green light, we would release this hawk. And this hawk would jump out of this Ferris wheel, tuck its wings in, and just scream past people's heads, ducking and diving onto the presenter's glove on stage. Just an absolutely phenomenal sight to see and something so amazing to be a part of. When I was in Canada and I was working at African Lion Safari, we were working with a huge array of different falcon species. Now falcons, if you're unaware, are they are the fastest species on planet Earth. We've got cheetahs and they're the fastest land animal on planet Earth. They run at a ridiculous fast speed on land. But when you get a falcon up high, they're perfectly designed for this. They're like a jet plane. They tuck their wings in and they dive. They dive straight down and they attack birds this way. So they've been clocked at going about 180 kilometers an hour versus a cheetah, which goes at about 110. So you can imagine if we could demonstrate this to people. Now, this is the great thing about what we do in zoos. If we can make people care, if we can inspire people, then we can also educate them at the same time, make sure they have fun, and they start caring more. When we start caring more, then we start caring for these animals in the wild more. So we thought, how can we demonstrate this to our visitors? So we actually got a massive helium balloon. And at the bottom of that balloon, we put a little box. And we asked one of the birds to go into this box. They went in. We released this thing about 100, 150 meters in the air. And then we had a little button we could push, open the box, and we had this falcon jump out and just dive straight down onto stage. And we had one of those police radar guns. So we cocked it going about 70 kilometers an hour. Doesn't represent the absolute pinnacle of their awesomeness with regards to their speed that I mentioned before, but absolutely awed everyone in that audience. And to be a part of that was just so much fun. The third bird nerd experience. Now, I wasn't involved in the training of this one. This is just something I partook in, but it's one of my favorite experiences of my entire life. I, in 2013, had an opportunity to go to Nepal and hang out with a guy called Scott Mason there, who's trained some Egyptian vultures to paraglide with him. Now, when you're thinking about birds and you're thinking about their behavior, there's nothing better than being a vulture and soaring as high as you can in the sky. So as a bird nerd, there is nothing better than being able to go into their environment and share that space with them. So with Scott, we had the opportunity, via paragliding, to jump off the side of a mountain, have an Egyptian vulture follow us out and soar around us while we're hundreds of meters up in the sky. Not only that, Scott's trained these birds where he can blow a whistle, and as the passenger in his paraglider, you get to stick your glove out, and we had the vultures landing on our gloves while we're flying around there hundreds of meters in the sky. So that, I think, takes the cake as one of my personal favorite training-related experiences of my entire life. And I think if you get an opportunity to go to Nepal, meet Scott, and do that, please do, because Asiatic vultures are in a lot of trouble. There's some drugs being used in that country that are in the cows, and the cows are dying. They're sacred over there. The vultures are eating them, and it's not good for them. So check that out as well, because Asiatic vultures need all of the support that we can give them. But yeah, hopefully that answers your question, Megan. I could go on and on and on and on and on, but some amazing things that we can achieve. The sky, to end this question, the sky is the limit when you think about what we can train with positive reinforcement.
Wow, that sounds amazing, flying with birds. I hadn't even thought that was actually possible. So tell us about the programs that you offer through the Animal Training Academy and who can take the class.
Yeah, of course. So the Animal Training Academy's been going, we're coming on 2 years now, and over that time I've built up a huge collection of resources online. So we've got resources, we've got packages that are free, all the way up to mentor programs where you and I sit down one-on-one and have a video call just like this, and then we do a couple of other things, and I'll talk about them soon. But firstly, let's start off for anyone that just wants to get started, that just wants to learn some new information. There's a ton of stuff that you can get started on right after you watch this video. So if you head over to www.animaltrainingacademy.com and you click in the main menu, it says free course. That's my labor of love. That's what I came up with first, and that's what I started putting out there. So that's 15 lessons in that free course. They have written content. They have video of me training a large array of different species. You can see some of those tamarins in there. You can see some of the possums we were talking about. You can meet my pets, my cats, and my dog. And there's also quizzes in there, and there's audio. So 15 lessons, jam-packed of information. So that's yours for free. And you can go and start learning on that today. Additionally, on the website, available completely for free is the Training Tidbits podcast series. So you can go on there, and I'm about to release episode 25, which I'm really excited about. But currently, there's hours upon hours upon hours of me talking with some of the world's leading experts on positive reinforcement animal training. And you can hear, I shared some of their stories earlier with that Harris Hawk and Lisa Longo with her amazing macaw parrots. There's tons of fantastic insights, stories. You'll be inspired, educated, and entertained at the same time. So those podcasts are completely free. That 15 lesson course is completely free. That's yours. Now, the next stage up is the membership structure. So you can actually jump in and you can get access to absolutely everything on Animal Training Academy. Now, that has a monthly subscription attached to it, a price attached to it. But what I'm going to do today, and we talked to Megan about this before we started recording, is going to offer you guys something really sensational, and I'm going to give you a trial period. So if you want to jump in Animal Training Academy, you want to get all that free stuff, and then you want to get the other four courses. So we have a clicker training course. So if you guys are unfamiliar with clicker training, this is a clicker right here, and this is a tool that we use frequently to train animals. It just makes a little sound, and my dog just stuck its head up when it heard that, wondering where her chicken was. And we've got a shaping course. So shaping is where we teach an animal what we want it to do. We think about the behavior we want from our animal. We think about the closest behavior it currently does. And then we think about all the little baby steps that it might take to get our animal from what it's currently doing to what we want it to do. And we use positive reinforcement to shape it, to teach it a new behavior. So there's a whole course on shaping. There's a course called The Recipe for Successful Behavior Management. And it's the 6 essential ingredients for behavior management. And there's all my archive lessons as well. So that's in the members area. There's a forum. Now, the forum is where all the amazing stuff happens. That's where I'm interacting with trainers one-on-one daily, and they are filming their animal training. They're uploading it. The community's coming together, and we're brainstorming new ideas about how we can move forward with their animal training. And they go away, they implement, they film. And so in the forums, that's where all the really cool stuff is going on, and there's so many videos in the forums of a huge array of different species. We've got those geckos in there, we've got the fish in there, we're working with giraffes, we're working with lemurs, we're working with red pandas, we're working with those cotton top tamarins, we're working with African grey parrots, Alexandrian parrots, sun conures, Antipodes island parakeets, macaws, we're working with dogs and cats, a different array of breeds, and the cats and ferrets, and I don't even know what else we've got going on in there. But that's a great place to learn. And you can go in there and you can say, hey, I'm Joe Bloggs from this place, and here's my animal, and here's a behavior I want to train. And I'll go in there and I'll see that and I'll reply, and other members will reply, and we'll start working on your individual training project as well. And then, on top of that, just started this month. Every month now, we're doing live classes online. So in the members area, you'll get access, you'll get invites to the live classes. And they happen about the 15th and the 30th of every month, and then the replays are also available in the members area. So you get all the courses, you get access to the forums, you get invites to live members only events, you get access to the replays, and that's the membership structure. Now I'm going to offer you a 10-day trial for $1, and Megan's going to put a link to that in the write-up for this video, the description for this video. You click on that link, and for $1 you can have a 10-day trial. I'll give you an invite to the next web class, and you can have access to all that stuff. We can even start your own individual training project in the forums. So that's really exciting. Now, the level up from that is all of that stuff, plus me and you connecting for a one-on-one video call where we will spend a couple of hours talking about behavior, just you and me, and also about your individual training project and your individual animal. And then I record that, and I give you that video back as well. So you get a copy of the video to keep for future reference. And also on top of that, I call it the VIP mentor program, I'm going to take your video. You're going to send me some video, and I'm going to do a video review. Now, I came up with this. No one else is doing this online, and it is a proven way to get success. People are reviewing other people's videos, but not doing what I've called the video edit. So you send me your video. What I do is I slow it down, I freeze it, I add writing to it, I put arrows in it, I highlight things, I zoom in, I talk over it, and I layer it with a ton of information. And this is a proven way to help get results when you're training, when we're working on things like timing, or we're working on things like our communication, and we're working on things like the hypersensitivity that we need to develop to our animal's body language. This way gets results, and there are already in the forums and in the shaping course a ton of video reviews I've done for other people. So it's a really powerful way to learn. And that's the mental package. And if you're interested in that, you can click on the contact page and on the website, www.animaltrainingacademy.com, contact me and we'll talk about setting up a mentor program for you. So that's kind of an overview of all the packages that I offer, from free to $1 for the trial, to the monthly membership, to the full-on one-on-one VIP mentor program. So there's something for everyone. And whether you want to go all out with me, or you just want to download some podcasts on your phone to listen to while you mow the lawns or drive your car to work, like I said, there's something for everyone.
Wow, thank you so much, Ryan. That is so awesome. I think a lot of people are definitely going to be taking advantage of that, because it's always important to train your pet and have a good relationship with your pet while training. So how can people get in contact with you for this option?
Yeah, thanks, Megan. And I agree. Sometimes before we train our animals, we have to spend a little bit of time training ourselves. Now, I'm all over the place. You can get in touch with me however it best suits you. Where do you hang out? Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, I don't know. You can find me on Twitter at Cartley2R. That's spelled at CARTLI2R. I'm on Instagram as RCart01. You can find me on YouTube, LinkedIn, or on Facebook as Animal Training Academy. If you search Animal Training Academy, you will find me. If you're on your mobile device and you want to listen to the podcast, just go to your podcast app, type in Animal Training Academy, and the podcast show will come up, and you can start downloading those directly onto your phone. I'm on iTunes with the podcast as well, so you can find me there. But overall, the best way is to head to my website. That's www.animaltrainingacademy.com, all one word, www.animaltrainingacademy.com. Once there, you'll see the link for the free course. You can register there. You just need to add your name and your email address to sign up, and that creates a membership for you, and then you'll just use that to log in every time you want to go there. And you'll find the contact form down the bottom. So if you scroll down to the bottom of any page, page, there's a green piece of writing. It just says contact. Click on that, and that will open up a page where you can send a message directly to my inbox. And that's one of the favorite ways that I like to hear from people. I love connecting with people one-on-one. I love learning about you and trying to do what I can and offer you what I can, whether it's a free lesson or whether it's the full-on mentor package to help facilitate your journey and to help get you get more of the behaviors that you want with your animals. Cheers, Megan.
Thank you so much, Ryan, for joining us today and telling us all about that. And that was a really fun experience getting to talk to you. And again, anybody that wants to get into contact with Ryan, you can go to animaltrainingacademy.com or view all of his other contact options. That's going to be linked down below in the description. Thanks for watching this video, and don't forget to subscribe to Happy Tales on YouTube to see more animal videos. I'll see you all next time. Bye!